either of the confessionary to be said by Father Primo. Tonight we celebrate the birth of the seminary on the West Coast of America in the city of Los Angeles. The Doctor of this church and the pioneer in this sphere, St. Mark the Evangelist, established the School of Theology in Alexandria during the first century, thus facing the numerous philosophies and idol worship. The School of Theology grew in a steady pace. It was the premise to the youth of the verses during the early centuries. The deans of the School of Alexandria were pillars of faith. They were the greatest theological scientists and leaders in the world, as Pontinus, Clement, Origen, Philemon the Blind. It is a well-known fact that through teaching of this school, the Christian faith owes its survival to the heretic, the heroic heights, the great knowledge, and the unblemished faith of our fathers, also Alexandria, St. Athanasius, St. Timothy, St. Cyril the Great, and St. Discourse, to name but a few. They were heroes of the Orthodox faith who had a great role in laying the foundation of the Christian creed in the world. It is known that many of the folks of our church used to be the deans of the School of Alexandria. Many Western theologians like Saint Jerome came to learn the true Christian teaching, proceedings, and the dogma from the great Egyptian leaders of the School of Alexandria. Once again, the seminary grew during the recent years, especially during the 30s of the current century. The Blessed Archdeacon Habib Kirkus paid too much attention to the seminary when he expanded it to the postgraduates and the evening classes. Mr. Nazir Gayet, or rather His Holiness Pope Shenouda the Third, Pope of Alexandria and Patriarch of See of St. Mark, then joined these classes. Needless to say that he graduated with the highest standing. Must be noted that he was studying and teaching at the same time. His Holiness had acquired the chairmanship and became the dean of the seminary when he was ordained a bishop of a church teaching and of the seminary. He still holds the post of the dean and teaches more than one subject beside the enormous responsibilities of his papal office. Pope Shenouda gives a special care for the expansion of the seminary, both in the longitudinal and in a transverse direction. Longitudinally, he increased the number of the branches of the seminary in several Egypt cities. Transversely, he initiated several postgraduate specialized institutions affiliated to the seminary, for example, the Institution of the Holy Bible, Public History, Christian Education and Psychology, etc. Now he expanded the Coptic Orthodox Seminary to the United States. both in the East Coast in New Jersey, and the Golden East Branch, and the Feast of the New Prophet in El Mayus, and here in the West in Los Angeles. The seminary in California was a dream, is now a reality. This would be a real base for service in the immigration land, where many students will be fully qualified for the services of the Church. We thank His Holiness for the trust He placed in us. We feel that we cannot realize our aspirations behind this project without the blessings, prayers, and support of His Holiness the Pope. We entreat our Lord Jesus Christ to keep Him for us for many years to come. Thank you.
Now, for the moment, when we move
Coptic language by Bishop Demetrius of Malawi. He will address the Coptic language for himself.
Se deixou que era metodista, né? Mas tinha duas mãos. Canafara, a nossa solução é marítima, a nossa escadaria, o adicionado para o treinamento da área da irmã. Assim, a linha Sampona, cantando Bruno Cor de Zambia, ao que esse dia, graças a Deus, de quem ele fez, o povo hoje.
Instructing people, teaching them.
and also correcting the false teaching of those who came before him and who were existing at his time, as for example the scribes and Pharisees. They always called him teacher, good teacher. Also the apostles. The apostles were teachers. When they ordained the seven deacons, they ordained them to carry on the social service, and the apostles to have all their time for teaching, to teach the world, to serve the word of God. The word of God for teaching was the way for establishing the church in the world. All the 12 apostles were teachers. All the bishops ordained by them were teachers also. We can read the commandment of St. Paul, the apostle, to his disciple Timothy, and also to his disciple Titus, to have care for teaching and for good teaching. Also, when St. Mark came to Egypt, he was also a teacher of Christianity. Through teaching, he could convert all Egypt to be Christians. He wrote his gospel as also a current of teaching. That was the word of the apostles, and also the word of the first bishops of the apostolic age. Also, teaching was the work of the great patriarchs of Christian of all Christian generations. When we speak about a great patriarch in the whole world as St. John Chrysostom, of course, St. John Chrysostom as the patriarch could perform many pastoral works, but he is known in the church as the teacher. St. Athanasius of Alexandria, St. Cyril of Alexandria, St. Dionysius of Alexandria, all these great heroes of faith were teachers of faith, were teachers of Christian knowledge, of Christian dogma, of Christian theology. All of them were teachers. Not only the teachers of the seminaries, but also the patriarchs, the bishops. The priests were teachers. Saint John Chrysostom obtained his great fame not only when he became a patriarch of Constantinople, but also since he was a priest in Antioch. He was a famous teacher in Antioch. Saint Augustine, for example, many of his famous works, famous books, were lectures given to the people, and some of them were the lectures of St. Augustine when he addressed the people during the Lent. And what can I say? Even deacons were teachers. When we read about St. Stephanus, the first deacon in the world, Although his work was to have care for the social life, but instead of this, he was a great teacher. He was a great teacher. He could convince many councils of the great philosophers at his time. And they couldn't resist the wisdom in which he spoke. And also the work of Sunday schools is teaching also. The work of every mother and every father is to teach their children, to instruct them, to give them the holy faith, the true knowledge of God. Then in what rank can we put Christian teaching? But theological seminaries may give a kind of teaching which may be called academic teaching. I don't prefer so much this type of academic teaching. I wish always to speak to people in a very simple way. In such simple way we can enter not only in their minds, but also in their hearts and deal with their will in a simple way. It was true that Saint Augustinus published a book named Contra Academus, against the academics. You may read it, but not in the center. We want you to know the correct Christian teaching, the true spiritual life based on the Bible, based on the tradition of the Holy Church, received from the Holy Apostles, received from our Lord Himself. Tonight, through God's will, I give you the first lecture in a subject of the New Testament. Only the lecture. And I leave room to send for you some other lectures from ahead. The lessons and the seminary will be in the English language. Because we want you to study and teach the children of the church, the adults, the teenagers. If you don't know the English language, how can you deal with them? How can you speak to them? How can you teach them? And also teaching in English language will give you a kind of practice in this language, and you will be acquainted to the biblical expressions, the liturgical expressions, the theological and dogmatic expressions, and also the spiritual expressions. We will leave just now after I end my discourse to you to go to the hall where we will get our lectures. Only students and our guests and the teachers, the priests and their wives, and the teachers and their wives. The rest of the people make pray for the lecture and may hear it from the video or from the cassette. Thanks to all of you. that account to me, but we should say a blessing at the end of our meeting. Jesus Christ.
Thank you. to be buried in the Gospel of St. John, as in this one and in this. But before speaking about this subject, I wish to say that the three other Gospels, the Gospel of St. Matthew, the Gospel of St. Mark, the Gospel of St. John, are called the Synoptic Gospels. That means Gospels of one vision. There is kind of similarity in these three Gospels, but St. John's Gospel is a unique Gospel. St. Matthew's Gospel had 28 chapters, 1,068
verses. St. Matthew's Gospel has 28 chapters and 1,068 verses. St. Mark's Gospel has 16 chapters, 661 verses. St. Luke's Gospel has 24 chapters, 1,149 verses. St. John, 21 chapters, 879 verses. The first Gospel which was written was the Gospel of St. Mark. It was written in Rome or in Alexandria for Rome, to the people of Rome. All the scholars of biblical studies say that the Gospel of St. Mark is the first Gospel to be written. And they say that it was written about the year 56. The second Gospel to be written is the Gospel of St. Matthew. Of course, it was written before the destruction of Jerusalem, which took place in the year 70. Because this Gospel has many prophecies about the destruction of Jerusalem, of course, before this. They say that it was written in Jerusalem, and they expect to be written between 56 and 58. The Gospel of St. Luke is the third Gospel to be written. They say that it was written in Caesarea during the captivity of St. Paul. And they expect to be about 59 or 60. And the last Gospel is the Gospel of St. John. They expect that it was written in Ephesus in the year 95. It was the last Gospel to be written. Of course, St. John didn't want to repeat what was written in other Gospels. So he selected some of the miracles of our Lord Jesus Christ, which are mentioned only in St. John's Gospel, except the Gospel of the blessing of the five loaves and the two fishes, which is the only miracle written in the four Gospels. The only one written in the four Gospels. And after it, walking on the sea. But all other miracles were written in St. John's Gospel alone. I'll let you know that But what was the key of St. John's Gospel? His goal.
Why
he wrote his gospel. This is found at the last chapters of his gospel, in chapter 20, verse 30 and 31. After mentioning or recording all the miracles and discourses of our Lord, he said, Many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye, you might have life through his name. These were written in order to believe that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of God, and believing in him, you will have life. This is the purpose of the gospel. To prove that Jesus is Christ, the Son of God, is a theological purpose. And in believing in him, you will have life. This is a spiritual purpose. So we have double purpose for this gospel, theological and spiritual. St. John's gospel was written by St. John, and St. John is called the beloved, and sometimes he is called the theologian. He teaches everyone that spirituality may be also the way of theologians. Theology is not the work of mind only, but theology is how to know Theos, how to know God, how to know him and how to live in him, and how to have life in him or through him. This is the true theology, not only philosophy, as some may consider theology as a part of philosophy. No, theology is to know God and live in God and love God, to love him and live in him, and not to leave him. How did he prove this? I'll tell you now how he proved. First, the Gospel of St. John is the Gospel speaking about Christ as the Son of God. The word Son is repeated so many times. But you may say that St. Peter said that Christ is the Son of God in St. Matthew chapter 16, verse 16. And many others said that our Lord is the Son of God. But St. John, in his gospel, was the only one to say that Christ was the only begotten Son. It is not found in other Gospels. The only begotten Son. I'll give you some examples of these points. If you read, for example, St. John Gospel, chapter 3, verse 16 and verse 18, what did he say? He says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish." Gave his only begotten Son. And in verse 18, "He that believes on him is not condemned, but he that believes not in he who believes not is condemned already, because he hasn't believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God." The only begotten Son. Because a person may say, all of us are sons of God. And all of us pray, saying, "Our Father who art in heaven." But Jesus is the only begotten Son. Why? We are sons through love, through faith. We are considered sons. But Jesus Christ is the only Son of God of his divinity, of his nature, of his essence. No one can be son in this name, in this meaning. To be born of his divinity, of his nature, to have the same nature, to have the same divinity. But we are sons, and at the same time are servants of God, and are creatures created by God. Our Lord Jesus Christ is the Son of God, the only begotten Son, before all generations, before the whole world was created. These are two examples. In chapter 1, verse 18, chapter 1, verse 18, he says, "No one has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him." The only begotten Son. And twice in chapter 3 and in chapter 1, verse 18. And also chapter 1, verse 14. "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father." The only begotten of the Father. These are four quotations from the first chapter of St. John and from the third chapter of St. John. And we can read the same in the first epistle of St. John, epistle chapter 4, verse 9 and 10. I read it for you. Herein is love. Not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation of our sins. Sometimes He says the Son, and only the word the Son means the Son of God and the only begotten Son. When we read about the miracle of giving sight to that man who was born blind in St. John Gospel, chapter 9, we hear these words. When that man was excommunicated by the scribes and Pharisees, and he was sent out of the synagogue, our Lord Jesus Christ met him and asked him, "Do you know the Son of God?" St. John Gospel, chapter 9, from verse 35. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and when he had found him, he said unto him, "Dost thou believe on the Son of God?" He answered and said, "Who is he, Lord, that I might believe on him?" And Jesus said unto him, "Thou hast both seen him, and it is he that talks with you." Who is the Son of God? If every person is the Son of God, then this title is not something extraordinary. But when this man asks, "Who is this, the Son of God?" that means the Son of God in a special meaning, giving the understanding of his divinity. And this man, and he said, "Lord, I believe," and he worshipped him. Who is the Son of God? And when he knew him, he worshipped him. In the Gospel of St. John, we hear this word, the Son only, the Son of God, in a way giving the meaning of divinity. But also, when some of the miracle took place, when they saw the greatness of the miracle, they began to confess their belief in the Son of God. I'll give you some examples. When St. John the Baptist saw the Holy Spirit laying on our Lord Jesus Christ during the baptism, what did he say? Chapter 1, verse 33 and 34. John the Baptist is saying, "And I knew him not, but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, Upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptized with the Holy Spirit. And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. He is bearing witness that this is the Son of God. Not in an ordinary meaning which was said about all people, as it was mentioned in Genesis chapter 6 before the flood. It was said, the sons of God now saw the daughters of men that they were fair, and they took them wives. The sons of God saw the daughters of men. All the sons of Sheesh, of Anush, were called the sons of God. But when John the Baptist witnesses, after seeing the Spirit on our Lord Jesus, witnesses that I knew that this is the Son of God, this is of another meaning. And also another witness from Nathanael, before being, at the time when he was chosen to be an apostle. Chapter 1, verse 48 and 49. Nathanael says unto him, whence knowest thou me? Jesus answered and said unto him, before that Philip called thee, when thou wast under the fig tree, I saw thee. Nathanael answered and said unto him, Rabbi, thou art the Son of God, thou art the King of Israel. The expression Son of God here is the expression of a person amazed when he saw a miracle, that our Lord Jesus Christ saw him. And that was not unknown to anybody. Also, during the raising of Lazarus, his friend, our Lord Jesus Christ seemed to be delaying in healing Lazarus. And the disciples were very sad when they heard that Lazarus was sick. Our Lord said to him, when Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. The Son of God may be glorified. The Jews considered that when he declares that he is the Son of God, that means blasphemy, considering death. For this reason, in St. John chapter 19, verse 7, the Jews answered him, we have law, and by our law he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God. If it is a normal title for everyone, then why he is condemned to death because he declared that he was the Son of God? The word Son of God in the Gospel of St. John means son of his divinity. Even when our Lord spoke in St. John's Gospel about himself as the Son of Man, he used this expression, the Son of Man, to declare his divinity. How? I may give you some examples. When he was speaking to Nicodemus in St. John Gospel chapter 3, he said to him, verse 13, and no man has ascended up to heaven but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven. No one ascended up to heaven but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven. Son of Man, who is the only one ascended to heaven and the only one who came down from heaven, and who is at the same time in heaven. While he is speaking to Nicodemus in Jerusalem, he is in Jerusalem and at the same time in heaven, that everywhere is abiding everywhere, and that is a proof of his divinity. Also, after this, when he says to Nicodemus, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. What is this Son of Man, that he who believes in him may have eternal life? He didn't say he who believes in God through him, but he who believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. This is the witness of St. John Gospel about Jesus Christ as God. And when our Lord spoke to Nathanael in the first chapter, verse 50, what did he say to him? Jesus answered and said unto him, because I said unto thee, I saw thee under the fig tree, believest thou? Thou shalt see greater things than this. And he said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, hereafter you shall see the heaven open, and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man. Not upon the Son of God. The heaven will be open, and the angels ascending and descending on the Son of Man. He always uses this expression, this terminology, the Son of Man, to prove his divinity. And also, when you read about the Son of Man forgiving sins, the Son of Man, the Lord of Sabbath, you will know the meaning of Son of Man. Before speaking about the miracles and discourses of our Lord Jesus Christ, I want to give you an idea about the style of St. John Gospel. St. John Gospel has a style of poetry, of music. You may notice the short sentences in St. John Gospel as music and a kind of rhythm. From the beginning, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. It's divided into sentences which has a certain rhythm as music. This same style is also the style of the first epistle of St. John. He was a man of poetry, man of music, man of beautiful style, which has impression in its tunes. Also, sometimes in his style, he repeats a word or a sentence to give the meaning or to give stress on the meaning. For example, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Or in the first was the Logos, and Logos was with God, and the Logos was God. The same word is repeated, giving stress on one word to give a meaning. For example, when he speaks about life, on this occasion I want to say to you that the Gospel of St. John has many subjects in which he has stress on. The word life is repeated so many times in the Gospel of St. John. The word light is repeated so many times in the Gospel of St. John. The word believes or not believe is repeated so many times. The word truth, the word world, the word Son of God. He has stress on some words, which may be one of the characteristics of the Gospel of St. John. I'll give you this example, for example, when he speaks about life. In the first chapter, he says, in Him was life, and the life was the light of men. In Him was life, and the life was light of men. In chapter 3, if we read verses 15, 16, 36, always speaking about life. For God so loved the world that gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. He that believes on the Son has everlasting life. verse 36. Whosoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. This terminology of eternal life, everlasting life, is repeated so many times in the Gospel of St. John, one of its characteristics. In chapter 4, verse 14, but whosoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be on him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. Chapter 5, verse 24. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that hears my word and believes on him that sent me has everlasting life. Chapter 4, verse 14. Chapter 5, the same. Many, many verses, especially in chapter 6, when he speaks about the heavenly bread descending from the heaven, giving life to all men. He who eats my body and drinks my blood shall have everlasting life, shall not die, shall live forever. Speaking about in chapter 6, you have about at least 6 verses speaking about eternal life, giving life to others. When he speaks about life, he says, the life was the light of men. And many verses are about light. I am the light of the world. Many, many examples. I don't want to count to you this, but at least you should know that this word is always repeated. Sometimes he gives a word which serves as the keynote of his discourse, as the word life or eternal life or the word light or the word truth. And sometimes he repeats the words. And sometimes he expresses the idea negatively or positively. I'll give you some examples. From chapter 1, verse 3. All things were made by him. This is positive. All things were made by him. And without him was not anything made that was made. He is expressing the meaning in a negative style and in a positive style. In verse 8, he is speaking about John the Baptist. He was not the light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. On verse 20, he confessed and denied not. Confessed means denied not, but positively and negatively. Sometimes he gives examples of sharp antithesis, the thing and its opposite. He may speak about life and death, about light and darkness, about truth and falsehood, about love and hate, about faith and unbelief, about Christ and the world, to make a kind of contrast in many of the verses. In the Gospel of St. John, we see that our Lord Jesus Christ is revealing himself to the world, revealing himself as the Son of God, as the Son of Man, as the life of the world, the true life, as the shepherd and the true shepherd, and the expression "I am so and so" is repeated many times in the Gospel of St. John. For example, he is saying, "I am the bread of life," chapter 6, verse 35. "I am the light of the world," chapter 8, verse 12, chapter 9, verse 5. "I am the good shepherd," repeated in chapter 10. "I am the resurrection and life," chapter 11. "I am the way, the truth and life," chapter 14, verse 6. "I am He." "I and the Father are one," chapter 10, verse 30. He is revealing himself. I am so and so. As our Lord the Father in the Old Testament sometimes was revealing himself saying, I am the God of Abraham, of Isaac, of Jacob. As he spoke to Moses in the burning bush, I am. How did he choose his miracles? First, I want to say that St. John said that the miracles of our Lord Jesus Christ were countless, not to be enumerated by anybody. And he said, at the end of his Gospel, chapter 21, verse 25, "And there are also many other things which Jesus did, that which, if they should be written, everyone, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written." If these miracles are written one by one, even contain the... But he chose some miracles written in gospel. For example, to why?